Hello everyone, welcome to AVLSI lecture number 21, part number 2. So today's topic we will be studying about basic current mirror. So before doing that, let's revisit all the points which we have discussed in the lecture number 21, part 1. So we have discussed why it is important to use current sources, and then why it is important to distribute the current over all over the chip. Because of process variations, you will not be able to accurately replicate the current to different locations on the chip. That's what we have studied. And from this master bias, that is the reference current circuit, we can transport the current to the different locations of the chip. For example, as you can see over here, if I expand this, you can transfer this current I3 to other section of the chip. Similarly, I2 and I1 can be transferred to the other sections of the chip. Any IR drop in the current part, that will be acceptable, because that would be just cause a small error in the current value. And then this current mirroring can be done locally also, just in this case. So first we distribute the current I3 over a long distance and some other section of the chip. And then since we know that the two transistors, if they are very much nearby, they will be matched accurately. So that's why we current mirror also locally, because of the accurate transistor matching, because of the vicinity. Okay, so that is all we have revised last time. Okay, on-chip current distribution. Now, let's begin with our topic today. Okay, so we have completed the revisiting the points of 21.1. And then let us see what are the few specifications of a current source, and then eventually the current mirror. So first of all, your current source should have a higher output impedance or higher output resistance. The current source should have a high value of Rout. Then comes the voltage compliance. So your current sources handles a certain range of voltages at the output. That is your minimum or your maximum voltages. Then it should be accuracy and process impedance. Process independence should be there for a current source. It should not depend upon any process parameter, so that its value may change. Then there should be a DC balance for the current mirrors. We will look into what do you mean by DC balance with examples, and also the input resistance for the current mirrors also play an important role. And these current sources are used for DC biasing, and which can be used to bias MOSFETs, right? It can also be used as an active load to get a maximum gain without an IR drop. So you remember, we don't use a resistive load, right? For example, for MOSFET amplifiers. So instead we use an active load in the form of current sources so that we can have a maximum gain without physically connecting a resistor. So these are the key specifications of my current mirror and current source eventually. Okay, now let's move on to the next one. So let's start with our basic current mirror, right? Now, a very basic, simple resistive biasing for MOS current sources. So we will study this. So what do we have is, we have to bias the MOSFET. So what we have done is, we have made an arrangement of a resistive divider R1 and R2, and we have VDD. So VG will be generated from this resistive divider. So VG formula will be R2 divided by R1 plus R2 into VDD, assuming that M1 is in saturation. So now your VGS value, your source voltage is zero, right? So your VGS value will be equal to VG. So VGS will be R2 divided by R1 plus R2 into VDD. Now, what is the drain current formula given by? The drain current ID1 is given approximately equal to Iout. You know, the current remains the same actually, right? And that is approximately equal to half mu n Cox W by L of 1 into VGS minus VTH1 the whole square. So instead of VGS1, we substitute R2 divided by R1 plus R2 into VDD minus VTH1 the whole square. So we cannot use such a biasing method for integrated circuit, because we have various issues with the resistors, right? Your resistors will occupy more space even than your active devices such as transistors. So from this 21.2.1 expression, what can we say? That your Iout depends upon process parameters. In this case, it is mu n Cox and also VTH. That means this mu n Cox and VTH value can vary with your process and temperature, right? So no two transistors, you know, will have same process parameters, and it also depends upon temperature. So basically, this circuit over here, figure 21.2.1, is not an ideal way to bias your MOSFETs. Okay, so you know, a very ideal way will be that we can design this current sources in analog circuit, which will be based on copying the current from a precisely defined reference current source. Okay, what do you mean by precisely defined? Reliable. We are reliable on this reference current source that its value won't change even with the process parameters, neither with the temperature. So that is what we are going to do. We are going to design the current sources in the analog circuits, which is based on the copying currents from your reliable reference current source. So how do we copy the current of a reference source? So here we have a use of a reference source to generate various currents. So this reference current generator will generate I reference, and then you can distribute it accordingly. Okay, either it can sink or source the current I1 and I2, right? So we have a solution. This is what you conceptually mean by copying current. So we will have a reference current. Let's assume that we have this reference current generator. So I reference is independent of process and temperature variations. So how do we generate the copies of this reference current, right? So this is an example, right? So here, what we do is we have a copy circuit over here, and this copy circuit will make sure that this current reaches to this transistor drain terminal, that is I copy. So let's see how that happens. So for a MOSFET, your ID1 is a function of VGS1, right? That means if my VGS1 in this circuit, if my copy circuit VGS1 is equal to my this transistor VGS2, then I can say ID1 is equal to ID2. And how I can say that? We know the formula for the drain current. Your drain current is given by half UNC aux W by L, VGS minus VTH. So we know if the voltages are equal, VGS1 is equal to VGS2, then the current also will be equal. Okay, and that's how we do it. So instead of this, VGS will substitute VGS2. So VGS2 will be inversely proportional to your ID2. Okay, that means if a transistor is biased at I reference, then it produces a VGS, which is inversely proportional to, which will inverse function of I reference. So that means if your if the voltage VGS in the equation 21.2.2 over here. Okay, this is the equation 21.2.2 is applied to the gate and source terminal of the second MOSFET, then the resulting current will be I out, okay? I out or I copy, right? And this will be a function of here it is, which is inverse function of I reference. And hence we get I out is equal to I reference. There will be a more subtle manner wherein we will be deriving this, but this is just a conceptual means of copying the current. It just requires that the VGS of both the transistors of the copy circuit as well as this transistor is same, and then rest it will take care. Your I reference will be generated in the I copy section, right? And how can we do that now? We have to design this copy circuit, right? So we can use a diode connected MOSFET. So two identical MOS devices can have equal gate to source current, and they operate in the saturation. Then they can carry equal currents if lambda is equal to zero. So the structure consisting of M1 and M2 over here, this is my current mirror. Right, we know a diode connected NMOS, it will be my copy circuit. So if I replace this copy circuit over here and I have my M2 transistor over here, I can say that my I reference will be approximately equal to I copy. So I have, you know, copied my current efficiently. So let us see, this is my basic current mirror which we are studying. Okay, and remember that M1 is a diode connected MOSFET, so already it is in the saturation. We have to make sure that M2 also remains in the saturation region, right? So the structure of M1 and M2 in this together is called as a current mirror. Now, let us analyze this in details a little bit. Okay, so neglecting the channel and modulation, that is, we are assuming that both M1 and M2 are long channel devices. How can we write I reference? I reference is flowing through M1 transistor, right? So I reference can be written as half mu n C ox W by L of 1 into VGS1 minus VTH1 the whole square. So this is the expression number 21.2.3. Next, I copy is the current flowing through M2 transistor. We are assuming that M2 is also working in the saturation region. So because the, as you can see over here, your VGS1 is equal to VGS2 because they are in parallel. So if the devices have the same VGSs, they will be in the same operating region. So M2 is also in the saturation region, right? So I copy current can be written as half mu n C ox W by L of 2 into VGS2 minus VTH2 the whole square. And now just now we saw that VGS1 and VGS2 are same because they are in parallel. We are also assuming that since M1 and M2 are in close vicinity to each other, they will have equal threshold voltage. Okay, so we are assuming further VTH1 is equal to VTH2 is equal to VTH. Now we are also assuming the process parameters are same. So mu n and C ox values are also same for both the transistors because they are in the near vicinity, right? So there's mu n C ox, half mu n C ox, and VGS1 and VGS2 are also same, and VTH is also same. So that will cancel out. So what is left out is, if I see carefully, if I divide I copy divided by I reference, all the terms will cancel out except W by L of 6. So I can finally write I copy is equal to W by L of 2 divided by W by L of 1 into I reference. And this formula is valid for only long channel devices. Now we can easily tune the value of W by L of 2 and W by L of 1, and we can create the copy from the reference. So we can create, you know, let's say half. So let's say W by L of 2 is 1 and W by L of 1 is 2. So I copy will be half of I reference. We can also make it reverse. Let's say W by L of 2 is 4 and W by L of 1 is 1. So I copy is 4 times I reference. In this way, we can create, copies of your current from your reference I reference generator, current generator. Okay. So this topology will allow precise copying of the current with no dependence on mu n C ox and VTH, and which are process parameters, but are temperature sensitive. So yeah, we don't have to worry about process parameters or neither the temperature sensitive parameters. And this is all assuming that lambda is equal to zero. But in reality, we know that the lambda is not equal to zero. So let us analyze the circuit in case of if my lambda is not equal to zero. Now here, if you be wondering why I've connected, what is this analog circuit? So basically it can be another current mirror or it can be an amplifier also. We have studied common source, common drain and common gate amplifier. It can be, this current can go to that circuit also, right? So this analog circuit can be, any of the amplifiers or another current mirror which requires this amount of current. Let's say I reference is 40 micro. So I copy has to be 80 micro. So that is how we can feed the current to the analog circuit, which requires around 80 microamperes. So this is our basic current mirror, right? In the exam, if they ask you to derive the expression of the output current is same as your I copy current. Okay. Many times in the reference books, they have written over here I out, which is the same as your I copy. Right, so don't get confused. So we can easily derive this very easily, right? It can be a 2 marks question. Derive the formula relating I copy and I reference, or I out and I reference. So these are the steps, and with the assumptions, this is valid only for lambda equal to zero. Now let's check it out. What happens if lambda is not equal to zero? Okay, I guess it's loading a little. So let us start now. Yeah. So basic current mirror with lambda not equal to zero. So let's look into further details into the circuit. VGS1 is equal to VGS2. That is already established because they are in parallel. Your VGS1 is also equal to VDS1 because M1 is a current mirror. We know that. But VDS1 is not equal to VDS2 because VGS2 is not equal to VDS2 because that is not diode connected, right? So there will be some form of non-linearity over here. So let's find what is RN looking into the M1 terminal. So if you see carefully, both the gate terminal and the drain terminal are tied together. So RN looking into the terminal will be 1 upon GM1 parallel to RO1. we know this is lambda is not equal to zero, so R01 will be present. So looking into the terminals, drain terminal of M1 transistor, you will get 1/gm1 parallel to R01. When R01 value is pretty high, so Rn will be approximately equal to 1/gm1, right? And let's just assume the following, that you know, we are sure that M1 operates in saturation. But since we are giving the same VGS voltage, your M2 also possibly will operate in the saturation region for this to work. VGS1 is equal to VGS2. VDS1 is equal to VGS1. These are the observations. VDS2 is not equal to VGS2. That is also observation. And VDS2 is equal to Vout. Okay, that is what we are assuming. Now, if we plot Vout versus Iout, this is how, what we will get. We know that a Vout is nothing but your VDS2. So your current will go on increasing and it will attain a saturation value. And after that, it will attain, you know, a constant increase in the current will be attained. So this is possible only when Vout value reaches VDS2 sat. Fine. Now, let's just analyze the equation. So we will arrive at an equation which is relating I copy to I reference for a basic current mirror with lambda equal not equal to zero. So let us start. So here we will consider the channel and modulation. So we will get I reference is equal to half mu n C aux W by L of 1 into VGS1 minus VTH1 the whole square into 1 plus lambda 1 into VDS1. So this additional term is coming because of channel and modulation parameter. Similarly, I copy will be written as I copy is equal to half mu n C aux W by L of 2 into VGS2 minus VTH2 the whole square into 1 plus lambda 2 VDS2. Okay. And now we know that VGS1 and VGS2 are same, right? And we are also assuming that VTH1 and VTH2 are also same, is equal to VTH. So what we will have is all the process parameters are also same. So if we divide I copy divided by I reference, the following terms will cancel out. Half mu n C aux VGS1 minus VTH the whole square, because VTH1 and VTH2 is equal to VTH and VGS1 is equal to VGS2. So these terms will cancel out. And what we are left out with, I copy is equal to W by L of 2 into 1 plus lambda 2 VDS2 divided by W by L of 1 into 1 plus lambda 1 VDS1 is equal to, into I reference. So this expression 21.2.8 is a relation relating I copy with I reference and which is valid for short channel devices. That means lambda is not equal to zero. Fine. So let's just go further. So further we can simplify this. So to order to suppress the effect of lambda, we can force VDS2 to be equal to VDS1, okay? Which will lead to a new current mirror circuit. So we will do that next. So what we have to do is, in order to make it, you know, expression more, you know, linear version, so we can say that, yeah, we will try to force VDS2 to be equal to VDS1. That will lead to a new current mirror circuit, which will be analyzed it further later on. But right now, what are we substituting? VDS2 from the diagram, we know it is equal to Vout. And VDS1 is equal to VGS. VGS1 basically, right? And which is equal to VGS2. So that is there. Let's see that whether we have assumed this. Yeah. So VDS1 is equal to VGS1 and VDS2 is equal to Vout. So that is what exactly we substituted over here, right? So lambda signified the channel length, correct? So for accurate mirroring, we keep the channel length same. Okay. Also for a particular nanometer technology, the channel length remains the same. So L will remain the same. That means lambda 1 will be approximately equal to lambda 2, right? So we can write this I copy is equal to W2 divided by W1 into 1 plus lambda Vout divided by 1 plus lambda VGS into I reference. Assuming that lambda is very, very small, right? So what we can do is, if X is very, very small, that is X is very, very small compared to one, your X square term can be neglected. So what do we do is, we have one plus X A1 divided by one plus X A2. So we'll multiply and divide by one minus X A2 divided by one minus X A2, right? And we open the bracket on both numerator and denominator. So what do we get? One plus X A2 minus X A1 minus X square A1 A2 divided by 1 plus X A2 minus X square into A2 A2. So actually this will we are assuming x square term to be neglected, so we will get approximately this as 1 plus x times a2 minus a1. Okay, now in our case also we will do the same exactly the similar process we will carry out. Just a moment, it's loading actually. Yeah, so we'll apply the same process over here. So here we have 1 plus x times a1, our x is lambda and a1 is v out and a2 is vgs. So this can be approximated as 1 plus x times a2 minus a1. So here we can approximate it as I copy is equal to w2 divided by w1 into 1 plus lambda times, okay, yeah, it has come. So yeah, I copy is equal to w2 divided by w1 into 1 plus lambda times v out minus vgs. Okay, here it is a2 minus a1, right? So here we will be v out minus vgs. And if we try to keep lambda small, that means the length will increase, you will have a long tunnel device, right? And once we do that, and once we make this v out almost equal to your vgs, then what can we say, right? We can say that I copy can be approximately equal to w2 by w1 into I reference. Only when we try to make this v out, that is your vds2, equal to your vgs value, then only we will make this term disappear, because this will be zero. And we are also assuming that lambda is, x is very, very small. So compared to your one, it will be very small. Hence, I copy can be approximately written as w2 divided by w1 into I reference. So this is the way we can scale, mirror, or replicate the current. Okay, where we are assuming that the channel length is long and L is very much greater compared to L minimum. L minimum is the minimum channel length of the foundry process. Okay. So foundry is the place where we manufacture or fabricate MOSFETs, millions of MOSFETs together, right? So using this simple current mirror circuit, even with lambda not equal to zero, we can still have I copy equated to I reference with some, I copy approximately equal to I reference with W2 and W1 relation over here. Okay. So if we can adjust, because channel length normally we keep the same. So we can only vary the widths of the two transistors, W2 and W1, and we can create a copy of your current effectively from your reference current generator, I reference. Okay, so I guess that will be all for today's session. Next time we will continue the topic on basic current mirror. So until then, have a good day and thank you.